Paul's letter to the church at Philippi, Philippians chapter 4. Give you just a little bit of background and setting when you get there. But if you find your place there in Philippians chapter 4, would you shout a big amen this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Paul's letter to the church at Philippi is one of his prison epistles. The Apostle Paul, it's important to understand, Paul is not sitting in an air-conditioned office, sipping on Starbucks, listening to a Spotify playlist while he's writing this letter. Paul is sitting in a prison cell. And I think it's important for us as the people of God to be reminded that we are never promised a problem-free life in Jesus. We are never promised a life free of suffering and adversity. Our adversity reminds us how much we need the Lord. See, the worst thing that could ever happen to you is for you to get in a place where you believe that you don't need God. That's the... If everything in life could just be so laid out, sometimes the enemy does that, lays life out so perfectly where you feel like that you don't need the Lord. I'm telling you this morning, whether you're on the highest mountaintop or you're in the lowest valley, we all need Jesus this morning. We all are desperately in need of the Lord. I like what one old songwriter says, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. In John 15, Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. We need the Lord. And so Paul is writing from a prison cell. And I want to pick up in verse number 4 of Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. It's interesting. As Paul is facing an uncertain future, notice what he pins down to the church. If you found your place, would you stand as we give reverence to the reading of God's word? Philippians chapter number 4, reading in verse number 4. The Bible says this, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Think about this. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Verse number 6 really, really leaves me scratching my head at times when I think of the circumstances in Paul's life. If anyone had the right to be anxious, Paul had a right to be anxious that day. And he says to us, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, somebody say everything. In everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, shall guard your hearts and your mind through Christ Jesus. With God's help this morning, I'd like to share on this thought, finding hope in the midst of your anxiety. Finding hope in the midst of your anxiety. Let us pray. Father, we love you this morning. God, we are grateful for an opportunity to be gathered together. Father, we never want to take for granted, Lord, that we are a part of the ecclesia. We are a part of the church, the called out people of God who are called to assemble together. And Lord, we thank you for what you've already done in this altar, God, how you have drawn people to yourself. God, how you have comforted hearts that are troubled, and you have done, Lord, mighty and great things. And God, we thank you that you You are a good God. You are not good just once in a while. You're good all of the time. And Lord, we just could never thank you enough. And Father, we pray now as we have read from your word, Lord, that you would minister to us. God, it takes more than a preacher. God, it takes more than a sermon. It takes more than what man can give to us. Lord, it takes the power and the presence of the Lord. So God, would you get personal with us today? Would you take a seat with us? Lord, would you tabernacle in our midst for just a little while, Lord, and God, begin to place your finger on our hearts and begin to reveal truths to us this morning. God, we'll be careful to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor for what's done. In Jesus' name, everybody said, Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Nearly 5 years ago in 2016, in the fall, I preached a sermon series entitled Mind Games, where I address the mental struggles of anxiety, depression, guilt, and shame, all from a biblical perspective. I was astonished to see the feedback that came from that sermon series. More than any other series that I've ever shared as a pastor, I got more feedback from that than all others combined. You say, well, why is that? I'll tell you exactly why. There was more feedback from the Mind Games series because there are a lot of Christians sitting in churches that struggle with anxiety and depression, but they suffer in silence. Somehow, some way along the way, they have fallen into the trap that don't talk about your anxiety in church. Don't talk about depression in church. Don't talk about your guilt and your shame in church, because people will look at you funny. People will look at you different. Listen, if there's any place we ought to be able to talk about our anxiety, it ought to be in the church. If there's any place that we can talk about our struggles in our mind, and some people say, well, you know, there's really no such thing as mental illness, and, you know, it's really just a figment of the imagination. And, no, I'll be honest with you this morning. I thought mental illness was just a figment of the imagination till I found myself in my own battle 9 years ago. Being honest, being transparent this morning, when people would come to me prior to 9 years ago and they would come and they would say, Pastor, please pray for me. I'm really struggling with anxiety. I would think things like this, just snap out of it. I wouldn't say that verbally, but I was thinking it. When they would talk about their depression, then I would think things like, well, just step out of it. How many would agree that it's not that easy? It's more complicated than that. And so as I begin to really, really battle this myself, I begin to understand the Word of God, and I begin to understand the context. People say, well, are you a better pastor now, pastoring the people of God, now that you've struggled your own battle with anxiety and depression? No, but I'm a lot more compassionate pastor now. I can understand your struggle a whole lot better now than I ever did before. And so I've been there, I've done that, but sometimes that we have this idea that there's this stigma and that we shouldn't talk about things like mental illness in the church. Listen, if God talks about it, we ought to be able to talk about it. If the Word of God addresses it, we should be able to address it, right? And what I've learned is that In my years of ministry is that transparency always breeds transparency. Vulnerability breeds more vulnerability. Silence breeds silence. When no one's talking about things, nobody ever says anything. But when someone gets enough courage to stand up and say, hey, pray for me because I am battling with this, I am struggling with this, most of the time what happens, somebody else gets the courage to say, guess what? You're not alone. I'm struggling with that also. And then you find out somebody else is also struggling with that. As believers in Christ, one of the reasons why God gave us the church is we do not have to face anything in this life alone. We do not have to suffer alone. If you believe it, say amen. And so in our text, The Apostle Paul is writing from a prison cell, and he gives us some instructions here concerning anxiety. And we have to be reminded that anxiety is just this tool in the hand of the enemy to destroy us. And as I talk about 9 years ago in my life, I was crippled and paralyzed. I went through what I call the dark night of the soul. For 3 months in my life, I literally was crippled by anxiety. I really felt like nobody understood. I honestly thought I would never get better. I really did. There were times that I thought, I'm literally going crazy. I have absolutely lost my mind. But anxiety is the tool of the enemy. The Bible says the enemy comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come. Aren't you glad that's not the end of the verse there? The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus says, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. See, here's what I want you to understand about anxiety. If you struggle with anxiety this morning, understand, number one, you're not alone. No matter if you feel all alone or not, you are not alone. The second thing I want you to understand is that you're not some second-rate Christian because you struggle with anxiety. You're not weak in the faith. You're just a human being that's walking through a sin-cursed, fallen world. And the third thing I want you to see this morning and understand is that God is not disappointed in you. God wants to help you. God wants to offer you hope. See, here's the thing is that when somebody tries to slap a label on you, and yes, you can see counselors and you can see psychiatrists and you can see psychologists, and there are some great things that they can teach you, but listen to me, they do not define who you are. They do not have the final say of who you are as a believer in Jesus Christ. We are who God says we are this morning. We have to refuse any label given to us as the people of God. It doesn't matter if someone says this is something chronic, this is something that you're going to be dealing with for the rest of your life. We have to choose to believe God's word is my final source of truth for my life. I'm not against medical doctors. I sought medical doctors' help during my time. I believe that they're sent to help us through seasons of life. But we don't continue to live there forever as the people of God. And so, if I'm honest this morning, and I believe that we all should be honest as the people of God, anxiety is still my greatest struggle in my Christian life to this day. More than anything else, anxiety at times will still try to creep up in my life and try to take control over my mind. Understand this morning, your mind is a battlefield. Your mind is a war zone. And we'll talk more about that later this morning. But to understand that we need to realize that we are not alone in our struggle. So the Word of God specifically addresses the subject of anxiety to give us hope and to give us victory. And while it's a real threat in our lives, we do not have to live in bondage. We do not have to live in fear and enslaved to anxiety. Anxiety does not have to control us forever as the people of God. If you believe it, say amen. So this morning, let's look into the scripture and find our hope in the midst of anxiety. The first thing I want you to note, I want you to jot down is number one, notice the admonition Paul gives us against anxiety. Notice the admonition that Paul gives us against anxiety. Verse 6, do not be anxious about anything. Paul tells us that we don't have to be anxious about anything. This is a loaded admonition from God. In an age full of anxiety, how is it possible to not be anxious about anything? Because at its core, everybody look right up here. At its core, anxiety is your picture of the future without God in it. That's what anxiety is. When you begin to picture the future without God, there is anxiety. That's exactly what it is. We begin to think things. We begin to travel into the future and all the what-if scenarios and the worst-case scenarios and all these different things are swarming around in our minds. And so anxiety is our picture of the future without God in it. But the good news is you'll never go to a place in your future where God is not already there. God is always with us. If you believe it, say amen. Amen. But today, people are anxious about almost everything. Anxious about finances. Anxious about the future. We're anxious about relationships, marriages, family relationships, children. How many would agree that children are a great source of anxiety? How many would agree that grown children can be a great source of anxiety in our lives? Sometimes our children just never grow up, do they? Right? But we worry about their health, and we worry about their relationships. We worry about their marriages, and we worry about their finances. We worry about their well-being. We have anxiety over our children. We have anxiety about over the career or lack thereof. Anxiety about health reports from the doctor, outstanding tests, and upcoming surgeries, and different things. And there are so many different things that we deal with in life that no one is free from the potential of anxiety in their life. But Paul, in the midst of this admonition, Paul shares two truths with us leading up to this admonition. The first one is this: rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. One thing that I've learned about anxiety, it's really hard to be consumed, because that's what anxiety really wants to do, is consume you to where you think about it in the morning, you think about it during the day, you think about it at nighttime, when you go to sleep, when you wake up, it's the first thing on your mind. It just consumes your life. It's hard to be consumed by anxiety when you are declaring praise and worship to God. It really is. It's hard. And so Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. And so we should always be rejoicing as the people of God. Why? Because it takes our focus off of our problems and onto God for who He is. Right? And if we're not careful, we'll focus so much on our problems that our problems get great big, and our God becomes really small. We should focus more on our God, and the more that we focus on God, the greater, the bigger that our God becomes, and the smaller that our problems become. So the Apostle Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice, but you say, Pastor, you don't understand what I'm going through, and you don't understand the struggles that I'm facing, and you don't understand the circumstances. It doesn't matter what our circumstances are. God is still God, and He still deserves our praise. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. If He has ever been worthy of our praise, He is still worthy of our praise today in 2021. If you believe it, say amen. So Paul says, for leading up to this, do not be anxious about anything. He says, number one, rejoice in the Lord always. But then he shares another truth with us. He says, the Lord is at hand. The phrase can better be translated as, the Lord is near to us. See, anxiety makes us feel like God is distant from us. Anxiety makes us feel like we're all alone, that nobody else understands, nobody else cares. Nobody else gets it. But the Bible teaches us that the Lord is near to us. Is anybody else thankful for the promise of God this morning that He said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you, that I will be with you always, even unto the end of the world? The Scripture teaches us that the Lord is near to us. God is not distant. God is not far away. See, anxiety makes you believe that God is unconcerned about us, that God has more important things to worry about. Understand, if it concerns you this morning, it concerns God. That you are the apple of God's eye this morning. And the anxiety is a lie to us. And anxiety is a liar. And it feeds off of lies that God is distant, that God is not in control. And the reality is that the Lord is near to us. It's kind of like, you remember when you were a kid and you're scared and you're walking through a dark place with your parents? What do you want to do? You want to come get up close to your father's side. You want to come get up close to your mom's side. Why? Because when you know they are near, everything is going to be okay. As long as I'm by my father's side, everything is going to be okay. See, anxiety is the lie that makes you believe everything is not going to be okay. And so many times as believers, we fall into the temptation and we fall into the trap of believing that everything is not going to be okay. And the reality is this morning is that anxiety thrives off of your feelings. Really does. Anxiety thrives off of your feelings. The problem with that is that your feelings are not the source of truth in your life. God's word is the source of truth for your life. There goes 5 months of sermon notes right there on the ground. God's word is the source of truth. Some of you are going to come up here and get a sermon to preach for next week. God's word is the source of truth. But if we're not careful, we'll just live according to our feelings. This is the way I feel, and so I'm going to live my life based on the way I feel. And we need to move and shift from that. I'm going to live my life on the basis of what God says, and sooner or later, my feelings are going to follow what is true, what God says about me. We will live our lives miserable if we always live by our feelings. Well, I feel this and I feel that. Nowhere in the scripture does God tell us and teach us to live by our feelings. The Bible says the just shall live by faith. Live by faith in what? The revealed word of God. This is the truth for our life. This is what God has revealed about you. This is what God has revealed about me. And so I'm going to live my life on the basis of God's revealed source of truth rather than on the feelings that I feel in my life. I have felt all alone in the midst of my anxiety, as patient as my wife was walking by my side during that time. I felt all alone many times in my struggle with anxiety, but the Lord was always near. Anxiety is a lie. Anxiety is a deception, but God offers us hope this morning. If you're thankful for that, say amen. Amen. Not only do we see the admonition against anxiety where Paul says to be anxious, do not be anxious about anything. But notice the antidote of anxiety. Notice the solution for the poison. That's what an antidote is. It's the reversal of the poison that you have ingested. Notice the reversal, the solution that God has in His Word, the hope for you and I this morning with all of the anxieties, for the things that are keeping us awake at night, for the things that are on our mind that are causing us to toss and turn, that we cannot sleep, we cannot find any peace, our mind is racing 100 miles an hour, we live in a life of chaos because we cannot shut our mind down for long enough to think straight. Notice the hope that God gives us in His Word. The antidote for anxiety. He says, do not be anxious about anything, but, notice this, in everything. So he says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Powerful. So what Paul is saying is that prayer is fueled by, it is the fuel of faith that extinguishes the flames of anxiety. Because once again, prayer shifts our focus off of our problems, off of our anxieties to the problem solver. Everybody look right up here. There has never been a problem in your life that God hasn't had a solution to. See, the scripture teaches that God is a God who has solutions to our problem. And not only that, but the scripture teaches us a step further than that, is that before you ever had a problem, God already had a solution. The Bible says that Jesus is the Lamb who was slain for you and I before the foundation of the world, before man ever sinned in the Garden of Eden. God already had a solution in the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus Christ. So prayer, what it does is it takes the focus off of our problems onto the problem solver. And we need to, part of us understanding the need for prayer is just to be reminded who it is that we are praying to. Number one, He is omnipotent. The God that we serve, understand, He is omnipotent. What's that mean? It means He is the all-powerful God. He is the creator God. He is the God that said, let there be light, and there was light. He is the God that spoke everything into existence out of nothing. This God that I'm talking about this morning, He has no rivals and He has no opposites. He is God alone. He sits on the throne and He is all powerful. The Bible says that all power underneath heaven and earth have been given to Him. And when you and I enter into the throne room of God, we are talking to the all powerful God. We need to be reminded who our God is. He's not a God without power. He's a God who has all power underneath heaven and earth. Not only is He omnipotent, He's omnipresent. It means He is everywhere at the same time. Listen, while you're on your knees talking to Him in your living room, He can be in the car with your children while they're driving down the road doing who knows what. Right? So we're not omnipresent. We can't be everywhere at once, so why don't we talk to the one who is? God, I can't be where they are, but God, I'm going to kneel before you, and I'm going to talk to you, and you're going to be right there by their side. Omnipresent. Our God is not only omnipotent, all-powerful, and omnipresent, but he's also omniscient. That means he is all-knowing. Not only does he know everything, think about this, but he sees the end from the beginning. He already knows the future. And so when we talk to God and we come to him in prayer, we're talking to the all-powerful God, the God who is everywhere at once, and he is the God who knows everything. By the way, when we pray, we don't have to inform God of anything. He already knows. Well, God, you know this person? Yeah, God's saying, I already know that. Well, God, don't you know? Yeah, I already know that. God's saying, I already know that. You don't need to inform God of anything. God already knows everything because he's omniscient. He knows what's best for you and I. He knows what's best for your children. He knows what's best for your grandchildren. He knows the plan and the purposes alone for our lives. And last but not least, he is omnibenevolent. That means that he is good all the time. God's goodness is not something that he does. It's who he is. It's ingrained into his character. That means that God cannot operate outside of his goodness because it's part of his character. So God is all-powerful, he's all-knowing, he's everywhere at once, and he's always good. Why wouldn't we want to call out to God? No wonder why Paul says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything. So what is that everything? It's anything that is bothering us, anything that is nagging us, anything that's causing us confusion and chaos in our minds and convincing us of worst-case scenarios and just the nagging fear and the phobia of life. Paul says, instead of being anxious about anything, in everything, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving to God, we should let our requests be made known unto God. Peter says it this way, casting all of your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. Understand this morning that God is a patient father with you. Understand that God is a loving God. He's not disappointed. God is not angry, and God is not mad at you. God is wanting to offer you hope and victory this morning in the midst of your anxieties. What parent wouldn't want to offer the best for their children? When your child comes to you in the middle of the night, do you yell at them and scream at them and get mad at them and send them away? No, you wrap your arms around them and you comfort them and you remind them that everything is going to be okay. How many would agree we serve a loving and a patient God this morning? And he wants to help us and he wants to give us hope this morning, because sometimes, I'm speaking from experience, sometimes we get so paralyzed and so crippled by anxiety that we feel hopeless in this life. And God is saying that you don't have to be hopeless this morning. You can cast all of your anxieties on me. Why? Because I care for you. Last but not least this morning, notice the aim in the place of anxiety. Paul said, the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Notice the significance of this. Notice Paul says, this peace that cannot be described, that's undescribable, will guard your heart and your mind through Christ. Why is that important? Because your mind is the battlefield. That's where this battle is taking place. Why is there a battle taking place in your mind? Because God wants all of your mind. What do you mean, God wants all of my mind? Well, the greatest commandment in the law is to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your and all of your strength. Love God with all of your mind. No wonder why your mind is a battlefield. Because the enemy wants what he cannot have. Remember, the reason why the enemy was kicked out, because he says, I want to be like the Most High God. The enemy wants what God wants. So the enemy wants your mind divided. It's as simple as that. And so the scripture tells us, gives us a few scriptures in the Word of God. Isaiah 26:3, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon you because he trusts in you. God says that you can be given this perfect peace. It's the peace of God. It's the peace that Jesus left us. He says, that will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon you. Notice, you got to keep your mind on God. to have this perfect peace because he trusts in you. You know, the greatest level of trust is trusting God with what is out of your control. See, it's easy to trust God with what is in our control. You know, hey, it's easy for me to trust God with my lawn at my house. I got a sprinkler system. I got a lawnmower. I've hired True Green to come and spray the weeds in my yard. God, I'm trusting you with it. A lot of that's in my control. Somebody say amen. But how about the things outside of our control? That's where faith gets real. And there are many things that are causing anxiety in our lives that are simply out of our control. And the Bible teaches us that God will give us perfect peace, whose mind is stayed upon thee. Why? Because he trusts in him. We have to trust in the nature of God. We have to trust in the character of God. We have to trust in the person of who God is. Romans 12 and 2 says this: be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind to prove what is the good and acceptable, perfect will of God. Listen, if you are not renewing your mind through the Word of God, you have no chance and you have no hope against anxiety in this life. The pattern of this world will get the upper hand on your life. Paul says, do not be conformed to this world. Don't let the pattern of this world control your mind, but instead be transformed. How are you transformed? Through the renewing of your mind. You have to think about what is true this morning. There goes my other 6 weeks of sermon notes. Man, I need to get a file for my sermon notes. Amen. I got everything. You think you have a lot of stuff in your purse? Just check a preacher's Bible, man. He's got a little bit of everything there. I'm not picking it up again. All right. We don't have a chance without renewing our mind. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you can prove what is that good and perfect and submissive will of God for your life. And then Paul, in our text, verse number 8, I love this. Paul says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. See, it's important what you think about in your battle with anxiety. Paul says, the first thing that he says is, if there's anything that's true, what is true? The Word of God. We need to be able to discern when the enemy is whispering in our voice. Because when the enemy talks to us, it's always a hopeless situation. Your circumstance is never going to get better. Your children are never going to get saved. Healing's never going to come in your life. That relationship's never going to get better. That's not true, and so we shouldn't think about those things. That's the voice of the enemy. And everybody look right up here. When the enemy whispers to us, the enemy is the liar and the father of all lies. So we have to stop thinking about what is not true and start thinking about what is true, what is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Why is that so important? Well, in the heat of my personal battle with anxiety, I learned a couple of principles that I wanted to leave you with this morning. Number one, dwelling on your anxiety only fuels more anxiety. I learned this the hard way. Isaiah was asking us last night when the first time we went to Memphis was at our house. I don't know why he was talking about it, but he was asking how old Bella was the first time we went to Memphis for treatment of her brain tumor, and then he asked how old he was, and he was just curious. I don't know what brought the conversation up, but I was a wreck in Memphis, Tennessee 9 years ago. While my wife... This is how horrible it was. While my wife was checking in my 20-month-old daughter for brain surgery to Le Bonheur Hospital with a newborn baby Isaiah and a 3-year-old daughter Hannah, I was across the street in another hospital in the emergency room thinking that I was convinced I either had a heart attack or I had a stroke. Something was bad wrong. And she was, man, bless her for being so strong, but I just fell apart in Memphis. All I could say, it was the second time. Bella was going into surgery the next day, and this was the second time that I'd been in the ER in a week, telling them something's wrong with me. They did blood work, they ran the scans, they did everything, and every time they came back, they said, everything's fine. But the problem was, everything wasn't fine. Everything wasn't fine. I'm telling you, I had the craziest symptoms in my body that I thought were never, ever possible. I was dry heaving between 25 and 30 times in the morning every time I would wake up. I was in a fog. Almost the only time that I found relief was while I was sleeping. That's why I wanted to sleep all the time. I was getting brain zaps. I lost my hearing at one point. At one point I was dragging my foot. All these crazy things were happening. And every time something new would happen, I would get on Google and I would start looking at what was going on. And I'm thinking, listen, you think I have a doctorate degree by WebD by now, man. You think, this guy, he's got it all figured out. But man, I'd be Googling my symptoms, and you know, your mind is never satisfied until you get the worst case scenario. Once you see the worst case scenario, that's what I've got. This is what's gonna happen. All of a sudden, you don't need doctors anymore. You got Google, you got WebDMD, you know, man. But you know what it did? It didn't make my anxiety any better. It got worse. It got worse. And my wife says, man, you're letting Google get in the way of God. You got to stop. She'd find me over here. What are you doing? Nothing. She could tell. Why? What's the principle? Dwelling on your anxiety only fuels more anxiety. So here's what I would say to you. And I honestly, the first time I came back to preach, I'll never forget this as long as I live. When I walked from my office to this door right here, I honestly felt like I was drunk and I was going to fall over. That's how messed up my mind was. I believe I had a mental breakdown in Memphis is what I really believe. That my mind got so overloaded that I simply lost control over my body. But you know what? The second thing I would tell you is at some point, you have to put a stake in the ground and you have to put your faith in what you know to be true. You have to put your faith in what you know to be true. Finally, I had to put my foot down and I had to go back to what I knew to be true in my life. What I knew to be true in my life is that God saved me. Nobody else saved me. That God changed my life. That God has done. And so I was able to go back to victories in my life and the things that the Lord had done. And listen, I had to confess to the Lord, God, I'm sorry. I have fallen for the temptation of anxiety. I really, really, really believed I would never be better. Some of you may be sitting under the sound of my voice thinking there's something majorly wrong with you and you're never going to be normal again. Everybody look right up here. God brought me through. I'm 99.9% better today because of the grace of God. Why? Because I was able to go back to what I know to be true. Sometimes we have to, in the midst of what we're going through, in the midst of the problems, and in the midst of the struggles, because we live in real life. We deal with bad things in life. I mean, having a daughter with a brain tumor is not a good thing, right? There was a perfect storm that happened in my life, and just the pressure and everything, it just got the best of me. But I was able to turn back to the Lord, and I wish I could tell you that, man, the next day it just got better, just like that. It's not how it works. Over time, slowly but surely, God was able to bring me through, and I was able to stand day by day. Sometimes those symptoms would come. I wouldn't get on Google. I would just go back to what I know to be true. God's going to bring me through. God is with me. God is for me. God is not against me, and I will be better on the authority of the Word of God, and the Lord has brought me through. And I have good news for you this morning. If you are in a struggle with anxiety, if you are crippled, and if you are paralyzed, and it seems like that you have no hope for a future, there is good news from the Word of God this morning, that you can bring everything to God by prayer, through supplication, with thanksgiving. You can let your request be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your heart and your mind through Christ. You will be better again in the name of Jesus. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. I don't know what it is that's keeping you up at night. I don't know what it is that you're struggling with, or that you've convinced yourself that life is over, life will never be the same, life will never be better than what it is. But it's time to stop dwelling on the anxiety. We've got to think on the things that are true and allow God to bring His healing into our lives. Here's the thing. Let me be transparent. I called my doctor, and my doctor put me on anxiety medicine. I would have never. I'm the guy that thought it wasn't even real. And here I am now being prescribed anxiety medicine. But you know what? I prayed about it, and I took it, and I took it for a season of my life. Here's what I believe about anxiety. It does not permanently control us as the people of God. It may be a season that we go through, but we won't stay there forever as God's people. It may be a season, and God used that for a season. And there are severities, and there's different types of anxieties, and, you know, psychiatrists. And I'm not against going and getting professional help, but some trust in chariots and some trust in horses. But we put our trust in the name of the Lord. Amen. There's hope for you this morning in the midst of your anxieties. Are you willing to bring them to Jesus? Let's bow for prayer.